A Waif on the Plains. By Bret Harte. Podcast 4 of 5. Chapter 8. When Clarence was once more in the busy street before the bank, it seemed clear to his boyish mind that, being now cast adrift upon the world and responsible to no one, there was no reason why he should not at once proceed to the nearest gold mines. The idea of returning to Mr. Peyton and Susie, as a disowned and abandoned outcast, was not to be thought of. He would purchase some kind of an outfit, such as he had seen the miners carry, and start off as soon as he had got his supper. But although one of his most delightful anticipations had been the unfettered freedom of ordering a meal at a restaurant, on entering the first one he found himself the object of so much curiosity, partly from his size and partly from his dress, which the unfortunate boy was beginning to suspect was really preposterous, and he turned away with a stammered excuse, and did not try another. Further on he found a baker's shop, where he refreshed himself with some gingerbread and lemon soda. At an adjacent grocery he purchased some herrings, smoked beef, and biscuits, as future provisions for his pack or kit. Then began his real quest for an outfit. In an hour he had secured ostensibly for some friend, to avoid curious inquiry, a pen, a blanket, a shovel, and pick, all of which he deposited at the baker's, his unostentatious headquarters, with the exception of a pair of disguising high boots that half hid his sailor trousers, which he kept to put on at the last. Even to his inexperience the cost of these articles seemed enormous. When his purchases were complete, of his entire capital scarcely $4 remained. Yet in the fond illusions of boyhood these rude appointments seemed possessed of far more value than the gold he had given in exchange for them, and he had enjoyed a child's delight in testing the transforming magic of money. Meanwhile, the feverish contact of the crowded street had, strange to say, increased his loneliness, while the ruder joviality of its dissipations began to fill him with vague uneasiness. The passing glimpse of dancing halls and gaudily whirled figures that seemed only feminine in their apparel, the shouts and boisterous choruses from concert rooms, the groups of drunken roisterers that congregated around the doors of saloons or, hilariously charging down the streets, elbowed him against the wall, or humorously insisted on his company, discomposed and frightened him. He had known rude companionship before, but it was serious, practical, and under control. There was something in this vulgar degradation of intellect and power qualities that Clarence had always boyishly worshipped which sickened and disillusioned him. Later on a pistol shot in a crowd beyond, the rush of eager men past him, the disclosure of a limp and helpless figure against the wall, the closing of the crowd again around it, although it stirred him with a fearful curiosity, actually shocked him less hopelessly than their brutish enjoyments and abandonment. It was in one of these rushes that he had been crushed against a swinging door, which, giving way to his pressure, disclosed to his wondering eyes a long, glitteringly adorned, and brightly lit room, densely filled with a silent, attentive throng in attitudes of decorous abstraction and preoccupation, that even the shouts and tumult at its very doors could not disturb. Men of all ranks and conditions, plainly or elaborately clad, were grouped together under this magic spell of silence and attention. The tables before them were covered with cards and loose heaps of gold and silver. A clicking, the rattling of an ivory ball, and the frequent, formal, lazy reiteration of some unintelligible sentence was all that he heard. But by a sudden instinct he understood it all. It was a gambling saloon. Encouraged by the decorous stillness, and the fact that everybody appeared too much engaged to notice him, the boy drew timidly beside one of the tables. It was covered with a number of cards, on which were placed certain sums of money. Looking down, Clarence saw that he was standing before a card that as yet had nothing on it. A single player at his side looked up, glanced at Clarence curiously, and then placed half a dozen gold pieces on the vacant card. Absorbed in the general aspect of the room and the players, Clarence did not notice that his neighbor won twice, and even thrice, upon that card. Becoming aware, however, that the player while gathering in his gains, was smilingly regarding him, he moved in some embarrassment to the other end of the table, where there seemed another gap in the crowd. It so chanced that there was also another vacant card. The previous neighbor of Clarence instantly shoved a sum of money across the table on the vacant card and won. At this, the other players began to regard Clarence singularly, one or two of the spectators smiled, and the boy, coloring, moved awkwardly away. But his sleeve was caught by the successful player, who, detaining him gently, put three gold pieces into his hand. "That's your share, sonny," he whispered. "Share for what?" stammered the astounded Clarence. "For bringing me the luck," said the man. Clarence stared. "Am I to play with it?" he said, glancing at the coins and then at the table, in ignorance of the stranger's meaning. "No, no," said the man hurriedly, "don't do that. You'll lose it, sonny, sure. Don't you see, you bring the luck to others, not to yourself. Keep it, old man, and run home."
"I don't want it.
I won't have it," said Clarence with a swift recollection of the manipulation of his purse that morning, and a sudden distrust of all mankind. "There." He turned back to the table and laid the money on the first vacant card he saw. In another moment, as it seemed to him, it was raked away by the dealer. A sense of relief came over him. "There," said the man, with an odd voice and a strange, fatuous look in his eye. "What did I tell you? You see, it's a loose so. Now," he added roughly, "get up and get out o' this, afore you lose the boots and shirt off yet." Clarence did not wait for a second command. With another glance round the room, he began to make his way through the crowd towards the front. But in that parting glance he caught a glimpse of a woman presiding over a wheel of fortune in a corner, whose face seemed familiar. He looked again, timidly. In spite of an extraordinary headdress or crown that she wore as the goddess of fortune, he recognized, twisted in its tinsel, a certain scarlet vine which he had seen before. In spite of the hoarse formula which she was continually repeating, he recognized the foreign accent. It was the woman of the stagecoach. With a sudden dread that she might recognize him, and likewise demand his services for luck, he turned and fled. Once more in the open air, there came upon him a vague loathing and horror of the restless madness and feverish distraction of this half-civilized city. It was the more powerful that it was vague, and the outcome of some inward instinct. He found himself longing for the pure air and sympathetic loneliness of the plains and wilderness. He began to yearn for the companionship of his humble associates, the teamster, the scout Gildersleeve, and even Jim Hooker. But above all and before all was the wild desire to get away from these maddening streets and their bewildering occupants. He ran back to the baker's, gathered his purchases together, took advantage of a friendly doorway to strap them on his boyish shoulders, slipped into a side street, and struck out at once for the outskirts. It had been his first intention to take stage to the nearest mining district, but the diminution of his small capital forbade that outlay, and he decided to walk there by the high road, of whose general direction he had informed himself. In half an hour the lights of the flat, struggling city, and their reflection in the shallow, turbid river before it, had sunk well behind him. The air was cool and soft, a yellow moon swam in the slight haze that rose above the tules, in the distance a few scattered cottonwoods and sycamores marked like sentinels the road. When he had walked some distance he sat down beneath one of them to make a frugal supper from the dry rations in his pack, but in the absence of any spring he was forced to quench his thirst with a glass of water in a wayside tavern. Here he was good-humoredly offered something stronger, which he declined, and replied to certain curious interrogations by saying that he expected to overtake his friends in a wagon further on. A new distrust of mankind had begun to make the boy an adept in innocent falsehood, the more deceptive as his careless, cheerful manner, the result of his relief at leaving the city, and his perfect ease in the loving companionship of night and nature, certainly gave no indication of his homelessness and poverty. It was long past midnight, when, weary in body, but still hopeful and happy in mind, he turned off the dusty road into a vast rolling expanse of wild oats, with the same sense of security of rest as a traveler to his inn. Here, completely screened from view by the tall stalks of grain that rose thickly around him to the height of a man's shoulder, he beat down a few of them for a bed, on which he deposited his blanket. Placing his pack for a pillow, he curled himself up in his blanket, and speedily fell asleep. He awoke at sunrise, refreshed, invigorated, and hungry. But he was forced to defer his first self-prepared breakfast until he had reached water, and a less dangerous place than the wild oat field to build his first campfire. This he found a mile further on, near some dwarf willows on the bank of a half-dry stream. Of his various efforts to prepare his first meal, the fire was the most successful, the coffee was somewhat too substantially thick, and the bacon and herring lacked definiteness of quality from having been cooked in the same vessel. In this boyish picnic he missed Susie, and recalled, perhaps a little bitterly, her coldness at parting. But the novelty of his situation, the brilliant sunshine and sense of freedom, and the road already awakening to dusty life with passing teams, dismissed everything but the future from his mind. Readjusting his pack, he stepped on cheerily. At noon he was overtaken by a teamster, who in return for a match to light his pipe gave him a lift of a dozen miles. It is to be feared that Clarence's account of himself was equally fanciful with his previous story, and that the teamster parted from him with a genuine regret, and a hope that he would soon be overtaken by his friends along the road. "And mind that you ain't such a fool agent to let em make you tote their dod blasted tools for them," he added unsuspectingly, pointing to Clarence's mining outfit. Thus saved the heaviest part of the day's journey, for the road was continually rising from the plains during the last 6 miles, Clarence was yet able to cover a considerable distance on foot before he halted for supper. Here he was again fortunate. An empty lumber team watering at the same spring, its driver offered to take Clarence's purchases, for the boy had profited by his late friend's suggestion to personally detach himself from his equipment to Buckeye Mills for a dollar, which would also include a shakedown passage for himself on the floor of the wagon. "I reckon you've been fooling away in Sacramento the money your parents give you for return stage fare, eh? Don't lie, sonny," he added grimly, as the now artful Clarence smiled diplomatically, "I been there myself." Luckily, the excuse that he was tired and sleepy prevented further dangerous questioning, and the boy was soon really in deep slumber on the wagon floor. He awoke betimes to find himself already in the mountains. Buckeye Mills was a straggling settlement, and Clarence prudently stopped any embarrassing inquiry from his friend by dropping off the wagon with his equipment as they entered it, and hurriedly saying goodbye from a crossroad through the woods. He had learned that the nearest mining camp was 5 miles away, and its direction was indicated by a long wooden flume, or waterway, that alternately appeared and disappeared on the flank of the mountain opposite. The cooler and drier air, the grateful shadow of pine and bay, and the spicy balsamic odors that everywhere greeted him, thrilled and exhilarated him. The trail plunging sometimes into an undisturbed forest, he started the birds before him like a flight of arrows through its dim recesses. At times he hung breathlessly over the blue depths of canyons where the same forests were repeated 1,000 feet below. Towards noon he struck into a rude road, evidently the thoroughfare of the locality, and was surprised to find that it, as well as the adjacent soil wherever disturbed, was a deep Indian red. Everywhere, along its sides, powdering the banks and boles of trees with its ruddy stain, in mounds and hillocks of piled dirt on the road, or in liquid paint-like pools, when a trickling stream had formed a gutter across it, there was always the same deep sanguinary color. Once or twice it became more vivid in contrast with the white teeth of quartz that peeped through it from the hillside or crossed the road in crumbled strata. One of those pieces Clarence picked up with a quickening pulse. It was veined and streaked with shining mica and tiny glittering cubes of mineral that looked like gold. The road now began to descend towards a winding stream, shrunken by drought and ditching, that glared dazzlingly in the sunlight from its white bars of sand, or glistened in shining sheets and channels. Along its banks, and even encroaching upon its bed, were scattered a few mud cabins, strange-looking wooden troughs and gutters, and here and there, glancing through the leaves, the white canvas of tents. The stumps of felled trees and blackened spaces, as of recent fires, marked the stream on either side. A sudden sense of disappointment overcame Clarence.
It looked vulgar, common, and worse than all familiar. It was like the unlovely outskirts of a dozen other prosaic settlements he had seen in less romantic localities. In that muddy red stream, pouring out of a wooden gutter, in which three or four bearded, slouching, half-naked figures were raking like chiffoniers, there was nothing to suggest the royal mettle. Yet he was so absorbed in gazing at the scene, and had walked so rapidly during the past few minutes, that he was startled, on turning a sharp corner of the road, to come abruptly upon an outlying dwelling. It was a nondescript building, half canvas and half boards. The interior seen through the open door was fitted up with side shelves, a counter carelessly piled with provisions, groceries, clothing, and hardware with no attempt at display or even ordinary selection, and a table, on which stood a demijohn and three or four dirty glasses. Two roughly dressed men, whose long, matted beards and hair left only their eyes and lips visible in the tangled hirsute wilderness below their slouched hats, were leaning against the opposite sides of the doorway, smoking. Almost thrown against them in the rapid momentum of his descent, Clarence halted violently. "Well, sonny, you needn't capsize the shanty," said the first man, without taking his pipe from his lips. "If you're looking for your ma, she and your Aunt Jane HEV just gone over to Parson Doolittle's to take tea," observed the second man lazily. "She allowed that you'd wait."
I'm going to the mines," explained Clarence, with some hesitation.
"I suppose this is the way." The two men took their pipes from their lips, looked at each other, completely wiped every vestige of expression from their faces with the back of their hands, turned their eyes into the interior of the cabin, and said, "Will yer come yer, now will yer?" Thus adjured, half a dozen men, also bearded and carrying pipes in their mouths, straggled out of the shanty, and, filing in front of it, squatted down, with their backs against the boards, and gazed comfortably at the boy. Clarence began to feel uneasy.
"I'll give," said one, taking out his pipe and grimly eyeing Clarence, $100 for him as he stands.
"And seein' as he's got that brand new rig out o' tools," said another, "I'll give $150 and the drinks. I've been," he added apologetically, "wantin' somethin' like this a long time."
"Well, Jen Lemon," said the man who had first spoken to him, looking at him by and large, talking in, so to speak, the general gait of him in single harness, bearing in mind the perfect freshness of him, and the coolness and size of his cheek, the easy downiness, previousness, and utter dante carré damnativeness of his coming year, "I think 200 ain't too much for him, and we'll call it a bargain." Clarence's previous experience of this grim, smileless Californian chaff was not calculated to restore his confidence. He drew away from the cabin, and repeated doggedly, "I asked you if this was the way to the mines."
"It are the mines, and these yer are the miners," said the first speaker gravely.
"Permit me to introduce him. This yer's Shasta Jim, this yer's Shotcard Billy, this is Nasty Bob, and this Slumgullion Dick. This yer's the Duke o' Chatham Street, the living skeleton, and me."
"May we ask, fair young sir," said the living skeleton, who, however, seemed in fairly robust condition, "whence came ye on the wings of the morning, and whose marble halls ye HEV left desolate?"
"I came across the plains, and got into Stockton 2 days ago on Mr. Payton's train," said Clarence, indignantly, seeing no reason now to conceal anything. "I came to Sacramento to find my cousin, who isn't living there anymore.
I don't see anything funny in that.
I came here to the mines to dig gold because Mr. Silsby, the man who was to bring me here and might have found my cousin for me, was killed by Indians."
"Hold up, sonny. Let me help ye," said the first speaker, rising to his feet.
"You didn't get killed by Injuns because you got lost out of a train with Silsby's infant darter. Payton picked you up while you was talking care of her, and 2 days arter you came up to the broken down Silsby wagons, with all the folks lying there slaughtered."
"Yes, sir," said Clarence, breathlessly with astonishment.
"And," continued the man, putting his hand gravely to his head as if to assist his memory, when you was all alone on the plains with that little child, you saw one of those redskins, as near to you as I be, watching the train, and you didn't breathe or move while he was there.
Yes, sir, said Clarence eagerly.
And you was shot at by Peyton, he thinking you was an Injun in the mesquite grass.
And you once shot a buffalo that had been pitched with you down a gully all by yourself.
Yes, said Clarence, crimson with wonder and pleasure.
You know me, then?
Well, yes, said the man gravely, parting his mustache with his fingers.
You see, you've been here before.
Before?
Me, repeated the astounded Clarence.
Yes, before.
Last night.
You was taller then, and hadn't cut your hair.
You cursed a good deal more than you do now.
You drank a man's share of whiskey, and you borrowed $50 to get to Sacramento with.
I reckon you haven't got it about you now, eh?
Clarence's brain reeled in utter confusion and hopeless terror. Was he going crazy, or had these cruel men learned his story from his faithless friends, and this was a part of the plot? He staggered forward, but the men had risen and quickly encircled him, as if to prevent his escape. In vague and helpless desperation he gasped.
What place is this?
Folks call it Deadman's Gulch.
Deadman's Gulch.
A flash of intelligence lit up the boy's blind confusion.
Deadman's Gulch.
Could it have been Jim Hooker who had really run away, and had taken his name? He turned half imploringly to the first speaker.
Wasn't he older than me, and bigger?
Didn't he have a smooth, round face and little eyes?
Didn't he talk hoarse?
Didn't he stopped hopelessly.
Yes, oh, he wasn't a bit like you, said the man musingly.
Yes, see, that's the HLL of it.
You're altogether too many and too various for this camp.
I don't know who's been here before, or what they have said, said Clarence desperately, yet even in that desperation retaining the dogged loyalty to his old playmate, which was part of his nature.
I don't know, and I don't care there.
I'm Clarence Brandt of Kentucky, I started in Silsby's train from St. Joe, and I'm going to the mines, and you can't stop me.
The man who had first spoken started, looked keenly at Clarence, and then turned to the others.
The gentleman known as the Living Skeleton had obtruded his huge bulk in front of the boy, and, gazing at him, said reflectively, "Darned if it don't look like one of Brandt's pups, sure."
"Are ye any relation to Colonel Hamilton Brandt of Louisville?" asked the first speaker.
Again that old question.
Poor Clarence hesitated, despairingly.
Was he to go through the same cross-examination he had undergone with the Paytons?
"Yes," he said doggedly, "I am, but he's dead, and you know it?"
"Dead, of course.
Sartin.
He's dead.
The colonel's planted," said the men in chorus.
"Well, yes," reflected the Living Skeleton ostentatiously, as one who spoke from experience.
"Ham Brandt's about as bony now as they make 'em."
"You bet.
About the dustiest, deadest corpse you can turn out," corroborated Slumgullion Dick, nodding his head gloomily to the others. "In point o' fact, es a corpse, about the last one I should care to go hunt in fur."
"The colonel's tech you'd be cold and clammy," concluded the Duke of Chatham Street, who had not yet spoken,
"sure.
But what did your mammy say about it?
Is she getting married agin?
Did she send ye here?"
It seemed to Clarence that the Duke of Chatham Street here received a kick from his companions, but the boy repeated doggedly.
"I came to Sacramento to find my cousin, Jackson Brandt, but he wasn't there."
"Jackson Brandt," echoed the first speaker, glancing at the others.
"Did your mother say he was your cousin?"
"Yes," said Clarence wearily.
"Goodbye."
"Hello, Sonny, where are you going?"
"To dig gold," said the boy.
"And you know you can't prevent me, if it isn't on your claim."
"I know the law."
He had heard Mr. Peyton discuss it at Stockton, and he fancied that the men, who were whispering among themselves, looked kinder than before, and as if they were no longer acting to him.
The first speaker laid his hand on his shoulder, and said, "All right, come with me, and I'll show you where to dig."
"Who are you?" said Clarence.
"You called yourself only me."
"Well, you can call me Flynn Tom Flynn. And you'll show me where I can dig myself."
"I will."
"Do you know," said Clarence timidly, yet with a half-conscious smile, "that I kinder bring luck."
The man looked down upon him, and said gravely, "But, as it struck Clarence, with a new kind of gravity, I believe you."
"Yes," said Clarence eagerly, as they walked along together, "I brought luck to a man in Sacramento the other day." And he related with great earnestness his experience in the gambling saloon. Not content with that, the sealed fountains of his childish deep being broken up by some mysterious sympathy, he spoke of his hospitable exploit with the passengers at the wayside bar, of the finding of his Fortunatus purse and his deposit at the bank. Whether that characteristic old-fashioned reticence which had been such an important factor for good or ill in his future had suddenly deserted him, or whether some extraordinary prepossession in his companion had affected him, he did not know, but by the time the pair had reached the hillside Flynn was in possession of all the boy's history. On one point only was his reserve unshaken. Conscious although he was of Jim Hooker's duplicity, he affected to treat it as a comrade's joke. They halted at last in the middle of an apparently fertile hillside. Clarence shifted his shovel from his shoulders, unslung his pen, and looked at Flynn.
"Dig anywhere here, where you like," said his companion carelessly, "and you'll be sure to find the color. Fill your pen with the dirt, go to that sluice, and let the water run in on the top of the pen, work in it round so," he added, illustrating a rotary motion with the vessel. "Keep doing that until all the soil is washed out of it, and you have only the black sand at the bottom. Then work that the same way until you see the color. Don't be afraid of washing the gold out of the pen, you couldn't do it if you tried. There, I'll leave you here, and you wait till I come back." With another grave nod and something like a smile in the only visible part of his bearded face, his eyes, he strode rapidly away. Clarence did not lose time. Selecting a spot where the grass was less thick, he broke through the soil and turned up two or three spadefuls of red soil. When he had filled the pen and raised it to his shoulder, he was astounded at its weight. He did not know that it was due to the red precipitate of iron that gave it its color. Staggering along with his burden to the running sluice, which looked like an open wooden gutter, at the foot of the hill, he began to carefully carry out Flynn's direction. The first dip of the pen in the running water carried off half the contents of the pen in liquid paint like ooze. For a moment he gave way to boyish satisfaction in the sight and touch of this unctuous solution, and dabbled his fingers in it. A few moments more of rinsing and he came to the sediment of fine black sand that was beneath it. Another plunge and swilling of water in the pen, and could he believe his eyes, a few yellow tiny scales, scarcely larger than pin's heads, glittered among the sand. He poured it off. But his companion was right, the lighter sand shifted from side to side with the water, but the glittering points remained adhering by their own tiny specific gravity to the smooth surface of the bottom. It was the color gold. Clarence's heart seemed to give a great leap within him. A vision of wealth, of independence, of power, sprang before his dazzled eyes, and a hand lightly touched him on the shoulder. He started. In his complete preoccupation and excitement, he had not heard the clatter of horse hoofs, and to his amazement Flynn was already beside him, mounted, and leading a second horse. "You can ride," he said shortly.
"Yes," stammered Clarence, "but..." "But we've only got 2 hours to reach Buckeye Mills in time to catch the downstage.
Drop all that, jump up, and come with me."
"But I've just found gold," said the boy excitedly.
"And I've just found your cousin. Come."
He spurred his horse across Clarence's scattered implements, half helped, half lifted the boy into the saddle of the second horse, and, with a cut of his riata over the animal's haunches, the next moment they were both galloping furiously away. Chapter 9. Torn suddenly from his prospective future, but too much dominated by the man beside him to protest, Clarence was silent until a rise in the road, a few minutes later, partly abetted their headlong speed, and gave him chance to recover his breath and courage.
"Where is my cousin?" he asked.
"In the southern county, 200 miles from here."
"Are we going to him?"
"Yes." They rode furiously forward again. It was nearly half an hour before they came to a longer ascent. Clarence could see that Flynn was from time to time examining him curiously under his slouched hat. This somewhat embarrassed him, but in his singular confidence in the man no distrust mingled with it.
"Ye never saw your cousin?" he asked.
"No," said Clarence, "nor he me. I don't think he knew me much, anyway."
"How old mout ye be, Clarence?"
11. "Well, as you're suthin of a pup," Clarence started, and recalled Peyton's first criticism of him, "I reckon to tell ye suthin. Ye ain't goin' to be skeered, or afeared, or lose your sand, I calculate, for skunkin' ain't in your breed.
Well, what if I told ye that this year cousin o' yours was the biggest devil unhung, that he'd just killed a man, and had to light out elsewhere, and that's why he didn't show up in Sacramento? What if I told you that?"
Clarence felt that this was somehow a little too much. He was perfectly truthful, and lifting his frank eyes to Flynn, he said,
"I should think you were talking a good deal like Jim Hooker."
His companion stared, and suddenly reined up his horse, then, bursting into a shout of laughter, he galloped ahead, from time to time shaking his head, slapping his legs, and making the dim woods ring with his boisterous mirth. Then, as suddenly becoming thoughtful again, he rode on rapidly for half an hour, only speaking to Clarence to urge him forward, and assisting his progress by lashing the haunches of his horse. Luckily, the boy was a good rider, a fact which Flynn seemed to thoroughly appreciate, or he would have been unseated a dozen times. At last the straggling sheds of Buckeye Mills came into softer purple view on the opposite mountain. Then, laying his hand on Clarence's shoulder as he reined in at his side, Flynn broke the silence.
"There, boy," he said, wiping the mirthful tears from his eyes.
"I was only foolin', only tryin' your grit. This your cousin I'm taking you to be as quiet and soft-spoken and as old-fashioned easy you be.
Why, he's that wrapped up in books and study that he lives alone in a big adobe ranch area among a lot o' Spanish, and he don't care to see his own countrymen.
Why, he's even changed his name, and calles himself Don Juan Robinson. But he's very rich, he owns 3 leagues of land and heaps of cattle and horses, and, glancing approvingly at Clarence's seat in the saddle, I reckon you'll achieve plenty of fun there."
"But," hesitated Clarence, to whom this proposal seemed only a repetition of Peyton's charitable offer, "I think I'd better stay here and dig gold with you."
"And I think you'd better not," said the man, with a gravity that was very like a settled determination. "But my cousin never came for me to Sacramento, nor sent, nor even wrote," persisted Clarence indignantly.
"Not to you, boy, but he wrote to the man whom he reckoned would bring you there, Jack Silsby, and left it in the care of the bank.
And Silsby, being dead, didn't come for the letter, and as you didn't ask for it when you came, and didn't even mention Silsby's name, that same letter was sent back to your cousin through me, because the bank thought we knew his whereabouts. It came to the gulch by an express rider, whilst you were prospectin' on the hillside. Rememberin' your story, I took the liberty of opening it, and found out that your cousin had told Silsby to bring you straight to him. So I'm only doin' now what Silsby would have done." Any momentary doubt or suspicion that might have risen in Clarence's mind vanished as he met his companion's steady and masterful eye. Even his disappointment was forgotten in the charm of this newfound friendship and protection. And as its outset had been marked by an unusual burst of confidence on Clarence's part, the boy, in his gratitude, now felt something of the timid shyness of a deeper feeling, and once more became reticent. They were in time to snatch a hasty meal at Buckeye Mills before the stage arrived, and Clarence noticed that his friend, despite his rough dress and lawless aspect, provoked a marked degree of respect from those he met, in which, perhaps, a wholesome fear was mingled. It is certain that the 2 best places in the stage were given up to them without protest, and that a careless, almost supercilious invitation to drink from Flynn was responded to with singular alacrity by all, including even two fastidiously dressed and previously reserved passengers. I am afraid that Clarence enjoyed this proof of his friend's singular dominance with a boyish pride, and, conscious of the curious eyes of the passengers, directed occasionally to himself, was somewhat ostentatious in his familiarity with this bearded autocrat. At noon the next day they left the stage at a wayside road station, and Flynn briefly informed Clarence that they must again take horses. This at first seemed difficult in that out-of-the-way settlement, where they alone had stopped, but a whisper from the driver in the ear of the station master produced a couple of fiery mustangs, with the same accompaniment of cautious awe and mystery. For the next 2 days they travelled on horseback, resting by night at the lodgings of one or other of Flynn's friends in the outskirts of a large town, where they arrived in the darkness, and left before day. To anyone more experienced than the simple-minded boy it would have been evident that Flynn was purposely avoiding the more travelled roads and conveyances, and when they changed horses again the next day's ride was through an apparently unbroken wilderness of scattered wood and rolling plain. Yet to Clarence, with his pantheistic reliance and joyous sympathy with nature, the change was filled with exhilarating pleasure. The vast seas of tossing wild oats, the hillside still variegated with strange flowers, the virgin freshness of untrodden woods and leafy aisles, whose floors of moss or bark were undisturbed by human footprint, were a keen delight and novelty. More than this, his quick eye, trained perceptions, and frontier knowledge now stood him in good stead. His intuitive sense of distance, instincts of woodcraft, and his unerring detection of those signs, landmarks, and guideposts of nature, undistinguishable to aught but birds and beasts and some children, were now of the greatest service to his less favored companion. In this part of their strange pilgrimage it was the boy who took the lead. Flynn, who during the past 2 days seemed to have fallen into a mood of watchful reserve, nodded his approbation. "This sort of thing's your best holt, boy," he said. "Men and cities ain't your little game." At the next stopping place Clarence had a surprise. They had again entered a town at nightfall, and lodged with another friend of Flynn's in rooms which from vague sounds appeared to be over a gambling saloon. Clarence woke late in the morning, and, descending into the street to mount for the day's journey, was startled to find that Flynn was not on the other horse, but that a well-dressed and handsome stranger had taken his place. But a laugh, and the familiar command, "Jump up, boy," made him look again. It was Flynn, but completely shaven of beard and mustache, closely clipped of hair, and in a fastidiously cut suit of black. "Then you didn't know me," said Flynn. "Not till you spoke," replied Clarence. "So much the better," said his friend sententiously, as he put spurs to his horse. But as they cantered through the street, Clarence, who had already become accustomed to the stranger's hirsute adornment, felt a little more awe of him. The profile of the mouth and chin now exposed to his sidelong glance was hard and stern, and slightly saturnine. Although unable at the time to identify it with anybody he had ever known, it seemed to the imaginative boy to be vaguely connected with some sad experience. But the eyes were thoughtful and kindly, and the boy later believed that if he had been more familiar with the face he would have loved it better. For it was the last and only day he was to see it, as, late that afternoon, after a dusty ride along more travelled highways, they reached their journey's end. It was a low-walled house, with red-tiled roofs showing against the dark green of venerable pear and fig trees, and a square courtyard in the center, where they had dismounted. A few words in Spanish from Flynn to one of the lounging peons admitted them to a wooden corridor, and thence to a long, low room, which to Clarence's eyes seemed literally piled with books and engravings. Here Flynn hurriedly bade him stay while he sought the host in another part of the building. But Clarence did not miss him, indeed, it may be feared, he forgot even the object of their journey in the new sensations that suddenly thronged upon him, and the boyish vista of the future that they seemed to open. He was dazed and intoxicated. He had never seen so many books before, he had never conceived of such lovely pictures. And yet in some vague way he thought he must have dreamt of them at some time. He had mounted a chair, and was gazing spellbound at an engraving of a sea fight when he heard Flynn's voice. His friend had quietly re-entered the room, in company with an oldish, half-foreign-looking man, evidently his relation. With no helping recollection, with no means of comparison beyond a vague idea that his cousin might look like himself, Clarence stood hopelessly before him. He had already made up his mind that he would have to go through the usual cross-questioning in regard to his father and family. He had even forlornly thought of inventing some innocent details to fill out his imperfect and unsatisfactory recollection. But, glancing up, he was surprised to find that his elderly cousin was as embarrassed as he was. Flynn, as usual, masterfully interposed. "Of course ye don't remember each other, and there ain't much that either of you knows about family matters, I reckon," he said grimly, "and as your cousin calls himself Don Juan Robinson," he added to Clarence, "it's just as well that you let Jackson Brand slide. I know him better than you, but you'll get used to him, and he to you, soon enough. At least, you'd better," he concluded, with his singular gravity. As he turned as if to leave the room with Clarence's embarrassed relative, much to that gentleman's apparent relief, the boy looked up at the latter and said timidly, "May I look at those books?" His cousin stopped, and glanced at him with the first expression of interest he had shown. "Ah, you read, you like books?" "Yes," said Clarence. As his cousin remained still looking at him thoughtfully, he added, "My hands are pretty clean, but I can wash them first, if you like." "You may look at them," said Don Juan smilingly, "and as they are old books you can wash your hands afterwards." And, turning to Flynn suddenly, with an air of relief, "I tell you what I'll do, I'll teach him Spanish." They left the room together, and Clarence turned eagerly to the shelves. They were old books, some indeed very old, queerly bound, and worm-eaten. Some were in foreign languages, but others in clear, bold English type, with quaint woodcuts and illustrations. One seemed to be a chronicle of battles and sieges, with pictured representations of combatants spitted with arrows, cleanly lopped off in limb, or toppled over distinctly by visible cannon shot. He was deep in its perusal when he heard the clatter of a horse's hoofs in the courtyard and the voice of Flynn. He ran to the window, and was astonished to see his friend already on horseback, taking leave of his host. For one instant Clarence felt one of those sudden revulsions of feeling common to his age, but which he had always timidly hidden under dogged demeanor. Flynn, his only friend. Flynn, his only boyish confidant. Flynn, his latest hero, was going away and forsaking him without a word of parting. It was true that he had only agreed to take him to his guardian, but still Flynn need not have left him without a word of hope or encouragement. With anyone else Clarence would probably have taken refuge in his usual Indian stoicism, but the same feeling that had impelled him to offer Flynn his boyish confidences on their first meeting now overpowered him. He dropped his book, ran out into the corridor, and made his way to the courtyard, just as Flynn galloped out from the arch. But the boy uttered a despairing shout that reached the rider. He drew rein, wheeled, halted, and sat facing Clarence impatiently. To add to Clarence's embarrassment, his cousin had lingered in the corridor, attracted by the interruption, and a peon, lounging in the archway, obsequiously approached Flynn's bridle rein. But the rider waved him off, and, turning sternly to Clarence, said, "What's the matter now?" "Nothing," said Clarence, striving to keep back the hot tears that rose in his eyes. "But you were going away without saying goodbye. You've been very kind to me, and I want to thank you." A deep flush crossed Flynn's face. Then glancing suspiciously towards the corridor, he said hurriedly, "Did he send you?" "No, I came myself." "I heard you going. All right. Goodbye." He leaned forward as if about to take Clarence's outstretched hand, checked himself suddenly with a grim smile, and taking from his pocket a gold coin handed it to the boy. Clarence took it, tossed it with a proud gesture to the waiting peon, who caught it thankfully, drew back a step from Flynn, and saying, with white cheeks, "I only wanted to say goodbye, dropped his hot eyes to the ground. But it did not seem to be his own voice that had spoken, nor his own self that had prompted the act. There was a quick interchange of glances between the departing guest and his late host, in which Flynn's eyes flashed with an odd, admiring fire, but when Clarence raised his head again he was gone. And as the boy turned back with a broken heart towards the corridor, his cousin laid his hand upon his shoulder.
"Muy hidalgament, Clarence," he said pleasantly.
"Yes, we shall make something of you."